evening. Thanks for being with us. I'm going to kind of hit some high points from this morning. I don't see any visitors, but I could miss somebody. We're glad you're here. Just a reminder that the ladies' Bible study is tomorrow night here at the building at 6 o'clock. We still have the flyer for the Boot Hill Youth Camp on the back. Adam said that if you'd like to donate to the pies and cobblers but don't feel like baking, he'll accept monetary donations and he'll go pick up some pies or cobblers or whatever we need. So if you could help out that way, that'd be great. It was wonderful to see Fred Rhodes here with us this morning. If you're watching us out there in the Facebook world or missed him this morning, jump on and see his lessons from this morning. They were pretty good. We will have a short vacation Bible school meeting right after services tonight, just down here in the front, to try to kind of start getting things in line. That'll be Wednesday nights in July. So plan on bringing your friends and recruiting people to come and see us on Wednesday nights in July for BBS. Youth group Wednesday at 2 o'clock. Continue to remember Rick Holden, as he had a rough couple days, so he's going to be having some more tests come up. Paula DeBurns having cancer treatments. Is there anything else that I didn't get?
Andrew said that some of the ladies are going to give him for coming to the Bible study. They're going to be the bread and butter at 4 o'clock.
So any of the ladies interested in meeting at Bread and Butter before the Bible study, they'll do that at 4 o'clock at Bread and Butter. If not, I'll turn it over to Carl. Hands are open for him.
Thank you, Lord, for this beautiful day. We ask you be Brother Ray and Sister Sal, as they're on her way, I think, to California or somewhere. But anyway, I ask you be with them, keep them safe. Thank you for the speaker we had this morning. I think we received much good from that, and that in his speech was to the point. We ask that you go with us to the rest of this night. Let us be mindful all blessings come from thee. Thank you for our elders and deacons, and thank you for each and every person and member that is here. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our first song tonight will be 219. 219. We'll sing all three verses.
All day long of Jesus I am singing, he my song of joy will ever be. All the while he keeps my heart bells ringing, for his love is everything to me.
second song tonight will be 238. 238. Sing verses 1, 2, and 4 of this one. 1, 2, and 4.
Thank you.
song would be 351, 351, if you want to mark that in your books.
Good evening. Good to be with you all tonight. Was out on Wednesday because I had a summer series down in Kennett. They send their regards up here to this congregation, and things seem to be going well down there. And then Bethany and Evelyn weren't here this morning because they were at Pee Wee Camp. And not to brag or anything, but my daughter got Camper of the Week, female, for this weekend. So make sure you congratulate her and embarrass her plenty for me. So, but anyway, so a lot of things happening, but good to be with you here this evening. On Sunday, January 26, 2020, my favorite basketball player of all time was killed in a helicopter accident on a hillside in Southern California. Never I would have thought that Kobe Bean Bryant would die at such a young age, the age of 41, and that he would die in such a way. However, in the aftermath of his death came a chilling tweet that was on Twitter. It was by a guy with his handle @et.noso. And on November the 13th, 2012, at 11:32 p.m., he wrote, "Kobe is going to end up dying in a helicopter crash." Now, there has been some questions on whether this was valid or not, and people have checked it out, and it seems to be true that this person actually predicted that Kobe would die in a helicopter accident. And we look at that and say, wow, that is amazing, right? That is amazing that someone could predict such a thing as that, and such precision, it seems like. But we might ask the question, could that be a coincidence? Could that just be an estimated guess? Well, come to find out, around that time in 2012, 7.5 years before he passed, we find that there was a news article that came out that talked about Kobe Bean Bryant buying a helicopter in order for him to be able to be with his family, as well as compete on the highest level in basketball. He bought a helicopter to get from point A to point B, back and forth between his house and the practice facility. And so it seems very easy for us to look at that prediction and say, well, this guy just put two and two together. He saw that he owned a helicopter and said, well, maybe that's what's going to happen. Maybe that's how he is going to die. But just imagine for a second if he was much more specific than he was in that tweet. What if this guy had said the time in which he would have died, the date, the location? How many other people would have died with him on that helicopter crash? Now that would be impressive, right? We would go back and say, whoa, that is amazing to be so precise about an event many years before time. And we would say, when we look at that, that has to be something beyond what we as human beings can do. In fact, we just sang that in the song, right? I don't know about tomorrow. We as people, as human beings, can't look into the future and see the future. If so, there would be no divorces. Why get a marriage if you know it's going to end in divorce? There'd be no sports gambling. There'd be no winners or losers. Everyone would know the score. There would be no car crashes. Why get in a car if you know you're going to crash, right? If we could see the future, our lives would change. But we as frail human beings can't see beyond the length of our nose sometimes. We can't see the future. We can't predict it in precise detail. And we know that when someone does that, there's something beyond themselves that they are doing. And that's really the claim of the Bible. The claim is that predictive prophecy reveals whether someone is speaking on behalf of God or not. That if they come and predict something in the name of the Lord, and it comes true, you know that they are a prophet. Look there in Deuteronomy chapter 18, in verses 21 and 22, and it says, "And if you say in your heart, how shall we know the word of the Lord has been spoken? verse 22, when a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, if the word does not come to pass or come true, that is a word that the Lord has not spoken. A prophet has spoken it presumptuously. You need not be afraid of him. So if he predicts something and it doesn't come true, he's not sent by the Lord. The verse is true in Jeremiah chapter 28 and verse 9, where it says, as for the prophet who prophesies peace, when the word of the prophet comes to pass, then it will be known that the Lord has truly sent the prophet. So if they predict what's right, we know if they do that in the name of the Lord that they were sent by God. And finally, in 2 Peter chapter 1, in verse 21, Peter says, for no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. And so what we see in the Scriptures is this claim that if you can see that this prediction from these prophets came true, it's evidence that they are truly speaking on behalf of God. And they are truly carried along by the Holy Spirit. Now, as we get further into this series, and we think about how we can prove that the Creator of all, the Designer of all, the one who gave us our moral compass, how we can then say that that Creator God is the God of the Bible, we need to set up some proofs to show how we know that, how we know that to be true. I think one of the strongest things that we can advocate for to prove that the Creator is the God of the Bible is this claim of predictive prophecy. Now, when we think about predictive prophecy, I want us to have some high criteria, so a high standard. We need to have a high standard to prove definitively to ourselves and to others who might be questioning, having plenty of questions about God. We need to find some definitive proof to say, this is from God. This was not made up. This was not fulfilled simply by these writers writing in these details, making it look good. But this is truly the work of God, that these people were truly carried by the Holy Spirit. And the criteria I have tonight is borrowed from a friend of mine. His name is Drew Kaiser. He's a preacher down near Birmingham, Alabama. It's actually a preacher that my sister-in-law had growing up. And he had three criteria that shows predictive prophecy as being more valid or more credible than others. Okay? The first one he says is when predictive prophecy is made far enough in advance, not to be contrived, not just to be made up, then we see more validity, more credibility to those promises, to those prophecies. Think, for instance, back to the Kobe instance. What if someone had predicted Kobe to die on that hillside by a helicopter 200 years beforehand? Well, if you would ask someone in the 1800s, or at least tell them, 1800s, this is what was going to happen. They would first say, what's basketball? Basketball wasn't invented yet. They would say, what's a helicopter? Those weren't invented yet either. And they might even say, what's a Kobe? Because that's not a very common name at that time, right? So it'd be far more impressive if the person predicting his death didn't even know who he was, didn't even know what basketball or helicopter was as well. So it needs to be made far ahead of time. So we know it's not just contrived. It's not just a good estimate, but it's something that it's actually given by God. The second criteria is that it's specific enough to eliminate the possibility of coincidental fulfillment. It can't be just a coincidence. A lot of times people make very general prophecies about the future. There's going to be wars in the future. There's going to be corruption in government. There's going to be the taxes are going to be higher down the line. Those are easy to make, right? Those are very general. But when you get it very specific, it lends more credibility to what you're saying. And the last criteria I have here is that it's impossible to stage the fulfillment. Impossible to stage that fulfillment. Now, y'all probably have heard of point shaving in sports, or you have someone that's betting on the team or maybe even against the team, and they're making the score based upon them being a manager or a player, trying to get it just in the right parameters for them to make some money. And so there is a tendency that if we do make prophecy, we want to see it fulfilled. And so there can be some self-interest in that. And so that's another thing that would lead to more credibility, more validity in the prophetic statements that we see, is that it's impossible to be fulfilled. Now, I would have to admit there are some of these criteria that go against some of the prophetic predictions in Scripture. Okay, and that's not saying that those things are not true. It's just saying that those are not the ones that we can ground our faith on. For instance, with the first one, it's made far enough advance. There's plenty of prophecies in the Scripture that are made right before it happens. That doesn't mean that it's not true. It just means that it's not as credible, as valid for us to be able to stake our whole lives, our eternities on. Second, we see some scriptures some prophecies that aren't quite as specific, that could be very much a coincidence. For instance, the prophecy that the Assyrians would come and destroy the nation of Israel. That would be a very general and very generic promise of the time, because the Assyrians were knocking out everyone. It made sense that they, this superpower, to come and knock out little old Israel. And then the third one, it's impossible to stage with fulfillment. Think about Jesus there as he goes into Jerusalem the week of his death. That he went and sent his disciples to go get a donkey to fulfill a prophecy from Zechariah. Now, all of these, I still believe, are valid prophecies. They're just maybe not the ones that we stake our eternity on. And so we want to have high criteria, high standards when it comes to proving whether God was behind the Bible, if God was behind the Scriptures that we have. Now, there's some problems with that, because there are many scholars in our day and time that believe that the writers of the Scriptures, quote-unquote, cook the books, okay? They inserted certain details later on down the line to make it look like predictive prophecy when it really wasn't, all right? This is a classic thing that many Old Testament, New Testament scholars speak about. One example is in the book of Isaiah, Isaiah 44 and 45, about a guy named Cyrus, king of Persia. It says there in Isaiah 44, starting in verse 24, "Thus says the Lord, your Redeemer, who formed you from the womb. I am the Lord, who made all things, who stretched out the heavens and spread out the earth by myself, who frustrates the signs of liars and makes fools of diviners, who turns wise men back and makes their knowledge foolish, who confirms the word of his servant and fulfills the counsel of his messengers, who says of Jerusalem, she shall be inhabited, and the cities of Judah, they shall be built, and I will raise up their ruins, who says to the deep, be dry, I will dry up your river, who says of Cyrus, he is my shepherd, and he shall fulfill all my purpose, saying of Jerusalem, she shall be built, and of the temple your foundation shall be laid. Then verse 1 of chapter 45, thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have grasped, to subdue nations before him, and to loose the belts of kings, to open doors before him, that gates may not be closed." Now, why this is important is that this prophesies that Cyrus the Great, king of Persia, would allow the Jewish people to go back into Jerusalem, to inhabit Jerusalem, and to rebuild the temple. Which is significant because of the dating of both Cyrus and Isaiah. See, Cyrus, he was one who came to power in 559 BC. So 559 BC, he came to power. About 20 years later, 538 BC, he let the Jews go back into their land. Okay, so that's 538. On the other hand, Isaiah's ministry was between 740 to 700 BC. So at the very least, if you take the 700 date, Isaiah prophesied 141 years before Cyrus came to the throne. That's a long time, right? For something to be prophesied and then to be made true. Even more surprising is that he prophesied his name, Cyrus,
more than 100 years before Cyrus was even born. That's amazing, isn't it? To prophesy something that far in advance, even to pick out his name and says, this is going to be the anointed of God. He's going to be the shepherd that's going to lead my people back home. Unfortunately, a lot of scholars say, well, this part of Isaiah must have been written a lot later. Or maybe they say, maybe this was prophesied early on. They just inserted his name down the line. In other words, they cut the books to make it look like an amazing prophecy. And so we have to deal somewhat with that when we talk about predictive prophecy, that some people are not going to believe because they don't believe in the integrity of the Bible. But there is one group of prophecy that I think really takes the cake, that I believe is definitive proof for us that there is predictive prophecies in the Scripture. And that is the messianic prophecies that we find about Jesus. And the advantage that we have with these prophecies is that we know for sure that they were predicted at least 200 to 250 years before Jesus was even born. And the reason we know that is we have this translation of the Old Testament. It's called the Septuagint. It is the Greek translation of the Hebrew Old Testament. And universally, scholars believe it was translated between 250 and 200 B.C., 250 to 200 years before Christ, okay? So they all unanimously say that. Now, I believe that Isaiah and others, other prophetic books, were finalized at least 400 and 500 years before the return of Christ. But if you at least believe 200, 500's not going to do much for you, okay? 200 is good enough, right? 200 is pretty significant. Like we said before, 200 years with Kobe Bryant. What is basketball? What is a helicopter? 200 years is pretty significant. Well, when we find these messianic prophecies from the Old Testament, what we find is that there are a lot of these prophecies that line up with the criteria that we mentioned before. They happened a long time ago, at least 200 years. They're specific. Finally, they aren't force fulfilled. What we find about Jesus is 200 years, at least 200 years before Jesus was born, it was prophesied that he would be of the line of Abraham, that he would be of the line of Judah, that he would be a shoot of Jesse, that he would be of the line of David. And I have these verses on here if you want to look at them later. But over and over, we see the lineage, the genealogy that had to be right for the Messiah. We see those come true in Jesus. Also, the Messiah had to be born of a virgin. Isaiah chapter 7 and verse 14. That's certainly a hard thing to force fulfill, right? The next one is that he was born in Bethlehem. We see that prophecy in Micah chapter 5 and verse 2, and it specifies a certain Bethlehem because there's actually two in that region. There is a Bethlehem of Galilee, there's one of Judah. He was supposed to be of the one of Judah, and that is where he was born. So he was born in the right place, and he was also born in the right time. According to Daniel chapter 2, we see this dream that Nebuchadnezzar had. And he dreamed of four different kingdoms that were to come. And Daniel said that Nebuchadnezzar, the Babylonian Empire, was the first one. And then we see through history, the second was the Medes and the Persians. Third was the Greeks, and finally it was the Romans that were supposed to come. And what it says there in Daniel chapter 2, verse 44, is in that fourth kingdom, during that time, during the Roman period, that is when the kingdom of God was supposed to come. So not only was Jesus born in the right place, but he was also born in the right time period. And by the way, none of this he could self-fulfill, right? This is all before he was even born. In fact, you would even look at his parents and say, they certainly didn't ask to have a kid outside of wedlock. In fact, Joseph wanted to divorce his wife because of that, to put her away quietly. And they certainly didn't necessarily want to have Jesus in Bethlehem. That was something that was forced by their government when Caesar Augustus created this census for them. And so all these things lined up just perfectly in Jesus. They're very specific. They are not something that's force fulfilled. And that's what we continuously see Jesus even in his life. There is more of the same specific prophecies that were made long beforehand that were not forced fulfilled. I've got some of them on the board. I just want to read them to you. First of all, Jesus was betrayed by a friend, a fulfillment of Psalm 41 and verse 9, who was paid 30 pieces of silver. Not 31, not 29, 30 pieces of silver, not gold, silver, in fulfillment of Zechariah 11 and verse 12. This money was to be thrown down into God's house and then used to buy a field of a potter, not a field of a carpenter, not a field of a farmer, a field of a potter, as fulfilling Zechariah 11 verse 13. Jesus was to be silent when falsely accused, Isaiah 53 verse 7. Jesus was to be mistreated, Isaiah 53 verse 3. Spat upon, Isaiah 50 verse 6. And mocked, Psalm 22 verses 7 and 8. Dying, Jesus was to pray for his persecutors, Isaiah 53 and verse 12. People would gamble for his clothes, Psalm 22 verse 18. He would die alongside of criminals, Isaiah 53 and verse 12. They would pierce his side, Zechariah 12 and verse 10. And not a bone would be broken, Psalm 34 and verse 20. All of these were prophesied hundreds of years, if not sometimes thousands of years, in advance of Jesus coming. They're very specific, and they were not forced fulfilled. It's amazing. It's amazing to see all these things. And this is just scratching the surface. There's many more. I challenge you to go this next week and just look. Type into Google, Messianic Prophecies Fulfilled in Jesus, and you will be absolutely overwhelmed. There are close to 300 of these Messianic prophecies that were fulfilled in Jesus. And many of them meet the high standard, the high criteria that we saw before. Now you might ask, how likely is for this to happen, to just happen, with a person? For all these predictions to be fulfilled so perfectly. Well, a publication called Science Speaks, we read that Dr. Peter Stoner used a probability theory to test how likely that just eight of the many prophecies about Jesus could actually happen by chance. His results, checked by the American Scientific Affiliation, show that the chance that any man would have lived from when the prophecy was made to the present time and fulfilled is fulfilled all eight is just 1 in 1 to the 17th power. Okay, so that's 1 with 17 zeros at the end. I didn't look this up, but I'm going to say that's a quintillion. It might be a gazillion, I don't know, but it's a lot, right? So 1 with 17 zeros at the end. To give you a visual, Dr. Stoner said that if we took that number of silver dollars, I have one on the screen, and spread them out all over Texas, this is the second largest state in our union, right? They would cover the whole state 2 feet deep. That's amazing, right? Think about that many coins and that huge of a state. And the probability of just eight of these prophecies coming true is like just picking up one in this sea of silver dollars. We don't just have eight, brothers and sisters. We have 300. We have 300. Isn't that amazing? And not only were these prophesied, not only what were they said to have been fulfilled all in Jesus, but the early believers could go and check this stuff out. They could go to Mary, the mother of Jesus, and say, where was Jesus born? Did you have sex before marriage? That would be kind of forward, wouldn't it? Did you have sex before you had Jesus? They could go to these disciples that saw his miracles. They could go to his disciples who saw the resurrection. They could go to the soldiers who saw his crucifixion, and they could validate these things. They could say, yes, this is really true. It was really fulfilled in Jesus. And so they, had a chance to check, and they believed based upon the testimony that they heard about Jesus. These 300 some odd predictions were fulfilled in Jesus, the Messiah. And for me, if I found some writing, some book that was written, say, 200 years ago, or maybe even more, and we find such precise predictions that can't be force fulfilled, that were very precise, that were well beforehand, if I see those predictions coming true time and time and time and time and time again, 300 times, I think I would read that book. I think I would listen to that book. And I might think that there is something to this book. Brothers and sisters, that's exactly what we have in the Bible. And we should pay attention to that book. We should pay attention because it's not just a group of writings written by people who were searching for God, simply just trying to imagine a God. But instead, they were people who were carried along by the Holy Spirit to write the very words of God so that we can have them today. And so as we see this predictive prophecy, let us understand, this shows us that the one who created us, who is the first cause of the universe, the one who designed us, who made us perfectly for our environment, the one who gave us that moral compass within us, no right and wrong, that he is the one who is displayed in the Bible as the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, the God of Israel, and ultimately the God that sent Jesus to die for me and for you. Let us realize that this stuff brings us to faith in the words that we read in the Scripture and proves to us that God is real, and that he is trying to communicate with us through his holy word. Let us believe and grow in that faith, seeing these prophecies fulfilled time and time again in the Scriptures, so that we can have more confidence in the Lord who has given us his word. Let's pray together. Dear God, our Father, we're thankful, Lord, that you have given us proof and evidence that you are real, and that you are trying to communicate with us through your word. We know, Lord, that these prophecies, there's just no way, Lord, that they could be devised by human mind, just by the imagination of man, but that you led them. You led these men to speak your word, to write down these words for us, and to show us that you were real and that you were active in our lives, and you want us to obey you. We pray, Lord, that we will listen to you. We will listen to your book. That we will give our whole lives to you, our Creator, our Redeemer, our friend. We ask this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus fulfilled all these prophecies to show us that when he died on the cross, for sure, he was dying for our sins. He was dying that we might have eternal life with God forever. And if there's someone here this evening that needs to respond to that good news, that Jesus really was the Son of God, that he was truly the creator and sustainer of all things, and he died for me and for you, you want to put him on in baptism, we would love to assist you in that. Or if you've gotten off the track and you need to grow in your faith, you need to grow in your obedience, you grow in your reverence for God, and you want the prayers of the congregation, we would love to do that for you as well. If there's any need, please come forward as we stand and sing this invitation song.
Trouble sometimes are here, feeling contempt with fear, freedom we hold dear,
now is at stake, now is at stake.
Coming soon, morning, morning, night, 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 night
troubles will soon be o'er. Happy forevermore. When we meet on that shore, free from all care, free from all care.
Rising up in the sky, telling this world goodbye. Homeward we will fly, glory to share. Jesus is coming.
Thank you for this day you've given us, and thankful for the wonderful opportunity to be here. We've enjoyed being with one another. We've enjoyed singing praises to your name and learning more about your word. We pray, Father, as we leave here tonight, that we realize it's just a short time between here and Wednesday, when we'll get to be here, be back together again. And I pray, Father, as we go out, we'll make these next few days count. We'll look for opportunities to spread your word, just like Fred said this morning, just to see a soul in front of us, one that we can help bring to you and ultimately spend eternity with. Help us keep that in mind this week as we go out. Bring us back to the next appointed time. In